Today, we're taking an in-depth look at the EpoMaker Shadow S, which was sent over by the folks at EpoMaker. The Shadow S is a tri-mode TKL mechanical keyboard with south-facing hot swap sockets, a plastic case, polycarbonate plate, volume knob, customizable LCD screen, and VIA compatibility. It's available from EpoMaker for just under $100 pre-built, with a choice between two colorways and four different switches. I was sent the white-brown colorway with Mulan switches. My first impression of the board isn't great. It doesn't feel very solid and does have a bit of give and bend to it. It's quite plasticky with a mix of glossy and matte pieces. The case is mainly beige with a slight texture, but on the back and front are these glossy plastic bars in dark brown. On the sides, you've got these indentations that kind of look like they'd be for RGB light bars, but those don't exist here. The bottom case piece is indented along the back and half of the sides. This gives you room on the sides for your fingers when picking the board up, which is nice. On the middle back, below that glossy accent piece, you've got a slot for your wireless dongle, a mode toggle, a toggle for Windows and Mac mode, and the USB-C port. On the bottom, you have four fixed rubber feet as well as two multi-stage feet. In the middle is a metal badge with some branding and other information. On top of the navigation cluster, you've got your LCD screen and volume knob in lieu of the print screen, scroll lock, and pause break keys that would usually reside there. To the left, you've got an extra key, which brings the total number of keys on this board to 85 plus the knob. Below the navigation cluster is a small light bar that can be customized using hotkeys. The included keycaps are nice and thick with a very slight texture. I couldn't find any information about what they're made of, but they seem to be PBT. Some of them have some rough edges and what seem to be molding remnants that look like they need sanding down. I'm not a huge fan of the legends here. I know most keyboard legends are rounded and curvy, but these skew a little bit too cartoony for my taste. They've also employed dye sublimation for these legends, but no reverse dye sub, so the dark brown keys have black legends and it looks quite bad in my opinion. The Mulan switch I received is a pre-lubed 3-pin linear switch with a palm stem, polycarbonate top housing, and nylon bottom housing. During normal typing on the stock keyboard, it doesn't make any unpleasant noise. Nothing scratchy, rattly, metallic, or pingy. If you put it right up against your ear though, you can hear some pinging. I was very happy to see that the Shadow S is held together with screws instead of tabs. There are four of these Phillips screws on the four corners of the board. However, even after I'd removed all four, the top case piece was not fully coming off. I could get the corners to lift, but the middle was staying firmly in place. I realized that unfortunately, there were tabs along the front and back of the top case piece. You've got six of these in total, and fortunately, they're not as difficult to undo as the tabs on most other keyboards. No tools necessary. You just have to pull toward the center of the board to undo each tab one at a time, and eventually the top case piece will come off. You can then flip the whole thing over and disconnect two cables, one for the daughter board and the other for the battery. Underneath the PCB, you have two sound dampening pieces, one sheet of foam and a slab of silicone. The screen is a discrete piece that's actually attached to the plate with tabs instead of soldered directly onto the PCB. This means that you'll need to disconnect it from the PCB first before you can lift the plate off. You can do this by pulling on this locking tab on the back of the PCB and carefully removing the ribbon cable. Around the perimeter of the polycarbonate plate are 12 pairs of foam gaskets. Underneath the plate, you have a sheet of sound dampening foam and a thin sheet of sound enhancing foam. Stuck to the top of the PCB is a thin layer of plastic, also for sound enhancement. You can also see holes for PCB mounted stabilizers on the PCB. The Shadow S is compatible with VIA for key mapping, but you will also need a JSON file. You can use VIA on the web or download it as a standalone app. The JSON file is available from the Shadow S product page on the EpoMaker website. Before you can load this, you'll need to enable the Design tab from the settings in VIA. From the newly activated Design tab, you can then click the Load button and select the JSON file. You can then go to the Configure tab, and if necessary, necessary, select the Shadow S from the device dropdown on the upper right. You can now customize key bindings on 4 different layers. The default one is layer 0, and layer 1 is accessible by holding down the FN key by default. The 3 keys on the top right are for the knob, the leftmost one for a counterclockwise turn, the middle one for a knob press, and the rightmost one for a clockwise turn. In the section labeled custom, you can find some custom functions for this specific keyboard, most of which correspond with the functions listed in the manual. LED logo refers to the small light bar underneath the navigation cluster. OLED refers to the LCD screen, and you can turn it off entirely with OLED power set or switch between different modes using OLED set down. There is a default clock mode that also shows the date, battery status, connection modes, and other information. The other two modes are for custom images, which you can set using a separate app. When I tried opening the tool, I got a message asking if I was sure I wanted to uninstall the software, meaning it was already installed on my PC. To my surprise, it seems that this is the exact same software that the Sidu ABM066 uses to customize the image on its screen. Looking at the two screens side by side, they don't seem to be exactly the same. The Shadow S seems to have a slightly bigger and brighter screen with a different color balance. You can also see a stark difference in viewing angles, with the Shadow S screen remaining bright and visible from a normal typing angle, unlike the ABM screen. Going back to the image tool, it's got some rudimentary drawing and animation tools, but you're better off just uploading your own images or animated GIFs. If you count the pixels on the image tool, you'll get 160 by 96, which is a 5:3 aspect ratio, and you'll want to upload only images and GIFs in this exact aspect ratio, because the tool will squish and stretch whatever you upload instead of adding black bars, which is a bummer. Let's first listen to the Shadow S as it came out of the box, and also pit it against two other TKLs I've reviewed in the past, both also in their stock forms, the RX Storm RX870 and the Sidu V87. The Shadow S and the RX sound quite similar to my ears, while the V87 sounds thin and insubstantial in comparison. I think this can be attributed to the two sound-enhancing sheets, one foam and the other plastic. The former two keyboards have both, while the V87 only has the foam. It seems like keyboard manufacturers have settled on a pretty reliable formula for good-sounding keyboards with the inclusion of these two sheets. Next, I'd like to see how the keyboard sounds without the two sound dampening pieces underneath the PCB, one a sheet of foam and the other a silicone slab. Removing the sound dampening pieces does not seem to have had much of an effect on sound. I think there is a difference, but it's very subtle and, to me, negligible. What removing the sound dampening does, however, is add some bounce and flex. This isn't something that I can personally feel while typing normally, but maybe it's something that's important to you, in which case you should be able to remove the sound dampening pieces without sacrificing anything in terms of sound. Next, let's try out different combinations of switches and keycaps. I will also put back both sound dampening pieces. First up are my one and only set of tactiles, the Mode Tomorrow switches, alongside the Mode Tomorrow double shot keycaps. And the second setup will try to maximize the thought with lubed Gateron Milky Pro Yellows and Cerakis ceramic keycaps, which I reviewed in my previous video. we get a pretty distinct three tiers of stock here, with the mode tomorrow config being clackiest, the stock config in the middle, and the Cherokee one being stockiest, which is not a surprising result. I think the Shadow S sounds great in all three configurations. The EpoMaker Shadow S continues the trend of great sounding pre-built keyboards straight out of the box that started for me with the Fekker K75. Like I said in the last chapter, manufacturers have found the stellar sound secret sauce. Those two sound enhancing sheets, alongside factory lubed switches and stabilizers. They also love adding tons of sound dampening, but in my experience, it's not really necessary and just serves to diminish flex and bounce when typing. So if sound is the only thing that matters to you, then you should be very happy with the Shadow S. In terms of features and usability, there's really nothing to complain about. For me though, the Shadow S is lacking in the aesthetics department. It looks kind of like a toy, from its case to its keycaps, and feels pretty cheap, especially when compared with the RX Storm RX870, which is also a plastic pre-built TKL that costs $100. However, the Shadow S does have a knob, screen, and via compatibility, while the RX does not. The novelty of screens has worn off for me, and I do have a macro pad with a knob, so neither of these first two things are really all that impactful to me. Via is nice to have, but for me on a TKL, there's really not any key functions I'm looking to remap. So you'll just have to weigh all of these factors for yourself to see if the Shadow S is worth it for you. For me personally, the RX is the more attractive offer at this form factor and price point. And that's my review of the EpoMaker Shadow S. What do you think about this keyboard? Do you own one? Has your experience matched up with mine? If you don't own one, would you pick it over the RX 870? Let us know in the comments. Thank you so much for watching.